Hi everyone, Dr. Jay here, and in this video we're going to talk about different types of data acquisition modes using GPR, ground penetrating radar. Now in the last video we kind of focused on one particular type of GPR system called a monostatic system, and that system looked kind of like this. So we have an antenna sitting on the ground, and that antenna is transmitting a radio wave pulse down into the subsurface. It interacts with a particular layer boundary here, and this, of course, is a contrast in dielectric properties and conductivity. And then we get a return signal from that layer boundary, which is then picked up by the system. This particular type of system is called a monostatic system, which means that there's just one unit which contains both the transmitting and the receiving parts of the system. TX for transmitting, RX for receiving. Now, the other option is, of course, to separate out the transmitting and receiving elements of the GPR, and that is called a bistatic system. So, you see here a couple of differences. One, obviously, the transmitting and receiving antennas are now offset from each other, which means that the reflected wave, or the radio wave that gets reflected at the layer interface and comes back up to the antenna, is now, the reflection point is now offset from the location of the actual antennas themselves. Whereas before, we're basically seeing straight down, straight below the GPR system. Now we can actually see offset from the GPR system, or at least from either one of the antennas. This system is called bistatic. We've separated out both the transmitting and receiving components. And this bistatic system gives us greater flexibility in what we can do with GPR. Why would that be? Well, let's back up for a second and talk about what we get from a GPR system. So the basic observations that we have from GPR are two-way travel time and amplitude. And we talked about this in one of our last videos. So just looking at the monostatic system again, we get the time it takes from the transmitted to the received signal, and then we get the amplitude of the return signal from this particular reflector. What's missing in this picture? What we don't get here is the velocity of the layer in between, like we did with the seismic methods. And why might that be important? Well, if we only know the two-way travel time, I'll call that lowercase t. What we need to know is the distance, I'll call that z, same as we did with seismic refraction, or the velocity. If we know the velocity, v, then we can work out what the distance is. So in other words, we have three unknown quantities. We have two-way travel time, distance, or depth for that wave to travel down and reflect back, and then the velocity of this layer. In the case of GPR, it's the two-way travel time, so we divide by 2, and divide by the depth. Now, what does this mean? So we have these three quantities, and we only can measure one of them. We can measure the two-way travel time, and we don't know the other two. So if we only have a monostatic system, that's all we can say. We can just say what the two-way travel time is, and if we have a borehole or some information about the geology of the area, we can try to kind of work out what these other quantities are. And oftentimes, these quantities are really of interest. So for example, the depth to the water table, the velocity of a particular geologic material, and how that relates to other properties like strength, things that we've talked about with seismic data. We can't do that with the monostatic system. Now with a bistatic system, we have more flexibility, as I said, and we can do some different things. One of the data acquisition modes that we can do is called WAR, wide angle reflection and refraction. And this is where we would take our receiving antenna and we would just move it along. And I'll give that a little superscript 2 to denote that it's the second location. And so now what we have here is a second reflection from the same interface picked up at our receiving antenna, but at a different distance now from our transmitter. And we have these two distances now. We have I'll call it x1 for the distance between the transmitting and receiving antenna at the first location, and x2 for the distance between the transmitting and receiving antennas at the second location. And now if you notice here, we have the same Z. This is of course assuming that we have the same Z. If we have a dipping layer, that's going to complicate this picture. We'll talk about that in a second. But if we have the same Z, the same velocity, we're now changing the X distance between the transmitting and receiving antenna, and we can work out essentially what this distance Z is to this layer interface by plotting how the two-way travel time changes with the antenna distance. We'll talk about that more in just a second. But so by doing this now, we can get an estimate of the depth to our layer interface, and that of course, with the two-way travel time, gives us information on the velocity of this layer. So this is why we want to have this more flexibility. Now, I've talked already, I mentioned the WAR, wide angle reflection and refraction. That's one type of acquisition mode we can do with a transmitting and receiving antenna. Another type is called reflection profiling, and this is a little bit simpler and a little more analogous to the monostatic setup. And I didn't draw that very well, my apologies. But basically, we're essentially sensing very similar to a monostatic setup. We're just offset a little bit now, and we're moving both of those antennas along at the same rate. So TX moves by the same amount as RX moves. I'll give that TX2 there, so we can tell that's the second location. Both locations are sensing, in this case, the same layer depth. Wouldn't necessarily have to be the case. As we move along, we might have changes in depth, and we'll pick that up as we move along. But this is basically just a two-antenna setup, which is allowing us to get a similar type of result as the monostatic system. We're just taking these two antennas and moving them along both at the same rate. So we don't get the absolute depth to the layer interfaces. We don't get the absolute velocities here like we do with the wide angle reflection and refraction, but we do get relative changes in layer depth. So if we have a reflective layer here, because of contrast and dielectric properties or whatever, if that's changing with depth as we move along, we don't know exactly what the total depth is, but we can trace out how that changes with distance or as we go along the survey. Okay, so we've got reflection profiling in the bistatic system. We have wide angle reflection and refraction. And then finally, we have what's called a common midpoint acquisition method. And the common midpoint acquisition method is, again, like the WAR method. It allows us to get the layer depth or layer interface depth as well as the velocity of that upper layer, but it's a little bit more laborious, I guess, because we have to move both antennas. So here we might start out with the transmitting and receiving antennas right next to each other, and then we move them away from each other by the same distance. And by doing this kind of outward spreading the transmitting and receiving antenna at the same rate, so we move the transmitting antenna to the left in this case, the receiving antenna to the right, we do it by the same distance, that ensures that the location that we're reflecting at, so this downgoing wave gets reflected in both cases, the location of the layer interface where these two reflections happen is at the same location in space. So in other words, in this particular flat layer case, it doesn't matter whether you use wide angle reflection refraction or common midpoint acquisition methods because the layer is horizontal. But if our layer is, let's say we have a layer which is dipping, well then if you are moving one antenna and not moving the other one, if you're moving the receiving antenna but not the transmitting antenna, then the result that you get won't allow you to get the depth to that interface because that interface depth is changing. With this particular acquisition method, the reflection point is always the same, and so what you're getting is the depth to that reflective layer at that particular point in space. And you're still getting the depth to that interface, you're still getting the velocity of this layer, but now by doing this uniform spreading out of the transmitting and receiving antenna, you're getting the depth to just that point. And it doesn't matter what the aerial changes are, it's just whatever that point is, that's what you're getting. And then you would have to move your system to the left or to the right if you wanted to get depth along that profile. And so this common midpoint technique is a very useful technique for getting this layer depth and velocities. without having to make the assumption of horizontal layers, which is even like what we had to do with seismic refraction or MASW. So we've got these three methods now, WAR, wide-angle reflection, refraction. We've got common midpoint acquisition, and then we've got reflection profiling by moving the transmitting and receiving antennas along. And basically, those are all bistatic system data acquisition modes. With a monostatic system, we basically only have the reflection profiling, where the distance between the transmitting and receiving antenna is zero, and so our offset is zero, and basically we're just seeing straight down in the antenna. Okay, so that's a summary of some of these data acquisition modes. There's one other thing which I want to point out, which is how do you use this data in order to be able to get the information about depth and velocity. So we had a similar problem to this with the seismic refraction data, where we have a x and t plot, and in this case, x is the distance between the transmitting and receiving antenna, and t is the two-way travel time, whereas before we had the total travel time for the refracted wave and the distance from the source to the receiver. In this case, it is, again, source to receiver distance, transmitter to receiver, and we call this the two-way travel time because it's a reflected wave. Now, as we remember, the slope of these lines on this XT plot is inversely related to the velocities. And there are actually a couple of different waves that occur when we have ground penetrating radar. Let me just draw quickly over here. So again, this is all for a bistatic system, two separate receiving and transmitting antennas. We actually have an air wave, which travels through the air from the transmitter to the receiver. Similar to the seismic source, if we hit the ground, we will generate an air wave, and that will travel to those geophones. We also have a direct wave in the medium. Again, similar to the seismic method, where we have this direct wave, which can be picked up. And then we have our reflected wave. And of course, the point at which we observe the reflected wave compared to the direct wave is going to depend on the velocities and the layer depth and all of that. So if we draw this on our XT plot, we might have the air wave here. And in this particular case, we've got T going down because this is how we often look at GPR, ground penetrating radar data, where T is going down into the ground. And then our ground. So we have the air wave, we have the ground wave, and I should point out that what the velocities of these are. So for the air wave, we have electromagnetic waves traveling through the air that's close to the speed of light in a vacuum. So as you get more mass, the speed of light meaning electromagnetic radiation, slows down. So this is approximately the time through the air, the travel time for the wave going through the air wave, is going to be approximately x over c, where c is the speed of light in a vacuum. And it won't be quite c because there is some air, but it'll be close to that. Now for the ground wave, we talked about the permittivity last time. The ground wave speed is going to be approximately x over c, and then there's going to be a factor which is related to the permittivity. And I'll just call that epsilon. So again, we have our speed of light, but it's modified now by this permittivity term. And then we have our reflected wave. So the reflected wave is going to, because this is a two-way travel time now for the reflected wave, what we'll get is we'll get a parabola, actually, which starts out at some offset. So to go all the way down and back, we'll get some offset here. And then as we stretch out, you can imagine if we stretch out our transmitting and receiving antennas very far away from each other, that's going to become very close to the ground wave time. So what we'll actually have is a parabola which starts out at some discrete point here on the time x curve, and then it'll approach, draw that a little better, it'll approach the ground wave speed. So this is now our reflected wave. So this move out that we observe here, this time distance kind of set of curves, describes the way that a ground penetrating radar signal looks if we have just a single reflector and we're, again, increasing our transmitter-receiver distances to be able to see these. So again, you can't see any of this with a monostatic system. You have to be able to separate those systems out. And as we increase that separation distance, we'll observe, obviously, increased two-way travel times, or travel times for the direct waves. And what that travel time is for the reflected wave, it'll start out with this directly up and down. So if our receiver and transmitter antennas are right next to each other, you bring this all the way up next to the transmitter. That straight up and down time will be this vertical offset here. So this is going to give us information about that depth. And then as you spread out, that's going to asymptotically approach this ground wave speed, which is going to also be related to the velocity of this layer. So by looking at the ground wave and by looking at where this reflected layer hyperbola asymptotes to, where it's asymptoting, we can actually work out what that permeability, what that permittivity term is, and calculate what the velocity is, the radio wave velocity in this upper layer. So by using this time and distance plot, just like we did for seismic refraction, we can do the same thing where we work out what are the velocities of this layer. And obviously if we have multiple layers, that's another step that we would have to take. But we can work out what is the velocity and what is the depth to this interface. So all of that to say, using bistatic GPR in either a WAR or a CMP mode allows us to get this information on depth to layer interface as well as the velocity of that upper layer. Okay, so I think with that, I'm going to wrap up this lecture on data acquisition modes, and I'll see you in the next video.